I mean, I think we're close.
Okay, well, I guess, you know, I guess I'll just go ahead and give a quick introduction for our section and introduce Claudia and Diana. Thank all you guys for coming.
We're close.
So we should wait a bit, or?
I think we can start.
Okay, cool. Thank you guys for joining. I'll just do a quick introduction of our section. I'm Michael Sivas. I co-teach this section with Abby Cougar-Hume, and Ashley Simone is our HMS faculty. For you guys that don't know, we have a writing component with the degree project, studio and seminar in the fall. And, you know, I think it's not just writing, it's also helping the students, clarify their ideas, et cetera, which, so it's great to have that component as part of these two semesters. And I think, you know, for everyone who doesn't know, degree project is both in the fall and the spring. And the fall is a seminar, is a research-based seminar. And, you know, we have the same students throughout the year. So, basically they're developing their project in the studio, environment this semester based on the research from last semester. And in our section, the topic is free time. And we use a kind of a broad definition, which is the non-productive use of time, which is a definition by Thorsten Veblen from his theory of the leisure class, which was published in 1899. So I guess turn of the century, two centuries ago, where again, there was a lot of kind of technological change in terms of the Industrial Revolution. And I think, you know, how architecture responds to that change is something that's interesting to us, how it becomes more of a medium to foster a kind of conversation. So we have the students in the fall. The first thing we have them look at is Super Studio's 12 Cautionary Tales, to kind of frame not only architecture as potentially a speculative medium, but, you know, something that can both talk about or foster a discussion about, optimism, but also it can be used as a lens to caution us in terms of where we might be headed or even where we currently are. So I think, you know, Diana and Claudia kind of really took this on. I would say, their project is relatively speculative. I still can't tell if it's a building or not. Or a kind of platform. I think, you know, throughout the semester, or both semesters, it's been, you know, quite exciting, watching them develop their project. In many ways, you know, their project didn't have a foreseeable outcome. So I think what's been interesting is that it's almost truly been an experiment, as the outcome was not something that was predetermined. And in their project, I think they've taken on what could be the immediate future, which, you know, parts of our environment which may be digital or augmented, that as of right now are under the purview of companies like Microsoft and, you know, big companies like Microsoft and Google and other startup companies. So not necessarily architects. And I think they'll frame this technology as something which is, you know, able to help us work or able to help us relax, et cetera. But I think a lot of how this technology is being thought about is how it takes what we already know and kind of replicates things in the environment with the idea that it is quote unquote seamless. So I think Diana and Claudia have questioned that and started to speculate on what, not only how those things might be framed, but also what it might mean for an architect to begin to design some of those things without just the simple pragmatics of, let's say, fitting in. are being seamless, being a major concern. I mean, in many cases, I would say they proved that things can both not fit and actually work. But I think the other exciting part of the project is that, you know, they kind of developed the platform for which they design multiple outcomes. There isn't necessarily a particular outcome to a project, or at least the way I see it. I know students would hate to hear this, but, you know, they could continue to make more outcomes with the platform they develop. It could even be something that's potentially handed off to other people, I think, as a way to kind of frame how to produce or how to construct these things. So on one hand, it's quite interesting that the outcome hasn't been predetermined. On the other hand, I guess, for me at least, I don't know if I've ever really totally understood what the project was about. And that's exciting in a way, because every presentation is quite different. Every time I hear them present, it seems like the project is a bit different, or I see it in a different way, or I even question, I guess, what my ideas were the previous time I'd seen them present. As a studio critic, we see their presentations all the time. So in many cases, this presentation could just be a rehash of a previous one. But I guess I'm excited to one, hear the discussion, and also to see, I guess, what for me will be a new presentation, just simply because it's kind of different every time. So, you know, I look forward to, you know, how Claudia and Diana will frame the discussion. And also to, as a studio critic, having seen the presentations, usually many times not being bored, because I guess this will be a new presentation for us as well. So Claudia and Diana, if you guys want to share your screen and get started.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Diana.
I'm Claudia.
And this is Projected Realities. So our project speculates on how architecture can start to be augmented by projected realities. And we're also exploring new methods of designing and representing virtual objects to explore how these can start to manipulate the experience of the space and the object that it contains. So we propose that physical architecture can be tempered by a malleable overlay, and this creates a new condition of space through the overlap of the physical and the virtual. We're trying to architecturalize memory by designing a set of fragmented spaces that are linked through the idea of view. So the set for us becomes the testing ground for designing projected realities, which are realized through simultaneous experience of various spaces and then augmented by multiple sight lines and viewpoints. So in the beginning of last semester, we looked at these two references. And with this, we're trying to address the role of architecture in an age of this like new virtual and augmented reality. And with these images, an issue we saw with virtual reality or these immersive simulations is that it's usually a more individual experience as specific to the viewer. You can see that on the left with the Walter Pitchell TV helmet project. But for us, we're trying to reverse engineer this more insular experience to make it a more shared and communal experience, as described in the Society of the Spectacle image. So last semester, we experimented with photogrammetry, which is a process of converting something physical into something that's digital. And we designed this set to be able to test these photos. So we did a series of tests where we reverse engineered the photogrammetry process by manipulating the physical object to create intentional errors in the results. And these are some of the experiments that we did. So with this, we're really interested in the process of how something physical can be digitally scanned in order to explore this like liminal boundary between the physical and the virtual.
Before this semester, we went for like a less analytical and technical oriented direction. So then we looked at Gideboard's Naked City drawing on the left and the plan of Hitchcock's Rear Window on the right. So for Gideboard's Naked City drawing, suggests how we remember experiences of fragments in a dreamlike way. And similarly, the understanding of architecture is generated in discrete moments that accumulates into coherent spatial experience. And that's shown by the image on the right. In the making of movie Rear Window, Hitchcock built only the parts that were needed for the camera to capture specific views. So the set use fragments of architecture to construct a whole world, allowing the experience of it to be still seamless as shown through the movie scenes. So the audience is always unaware of the fragmentation. As you can see in the recreated plan shown on the right, spaces are rearranged, discarding original levels and adjacencies as if architecture becomes a stage set. And these images depict the experiences of Guy Debord's Naked City drawing of Paris and Hitchcock's Rear Window set. And while these images appear to be quite ordinary, and the drawings of both of these experiences present different realities. And the two examples took fragments of existing places and rearranged them to produce another version of that world. So the set for us, that's the same thing. We're not designing a building, rather we are designing a physical set of spaces to test the design of projected realities. So the set is a version of the site which architectualizes memory resolved through the window in each fragment.
So we're going to show a series of plans that shows the development of our set. And for us, the project utilizes these more like prototypical spaces in New York City that would be encountered by someone who lives in Midtown. And this routine is like broken up into fragments of spaces and experiences. And for us, we're taking these fragments out of Midtown, out of the context of the city, because geographical connections don't really matter, but it's more about how these fragments will become rearranged through visual experiences. So we created, we're arranging these fragments through visual linkages created by nested views. And what we mean by nested views is that you would be able to see a fragment through the window or opening of another. And we initially established these series of six nested views, but kind of realized that these views overlapped. And in order to entangle these views, these fragments were taken out of its normal geographical context and then rearranged to accommodate view. So then these fragments start to get scaled and reoriented in accordance to view. And in order to reconcile parts of the fragments into the view of another, we have to distort some of these. And then this was the six finalized viewpoints. So the idea of view and the human view becomes crucial to our project as these views start to activate the construction of these spaces. And the creation of the set was developed through rearranging, reorienting, and also like distorting these existing fragments of Midtown to create this cohesive experience of all these spaces. And for like, at first, the initial idea of the project was to have this like physically built as a large like set-like model and place cameras to use to experiment. So some of the initial moves that we did were based on the idea scale to be able to physically build this. But as this project had to shift into the virtual realm, the idea of view cones and nested view became like the new criteria.
Yeah, and to like further explain the idea, so the creation of the set is resolved through the window as windows or paintings, they flatten another world into a plane so that it coexists with the existing space. And the windows in our project are how another fragment is nested into each experiential view. Each established view offers a view into another fragment through the window, creating a view within a view condition that is similar to the effect that we are showing here with the movie. And in our set, these fragments are arranged through visual linkages created through nested views. And what we mean by that is each space is shown twice, once as the experience of someone within that space, another through the window of a different space. So, although we only have six cameras or six viewpoints set up in our set, one viewpoint for each fragment, we have each fragment viewed twice. And for example, here you see the apartment through the window of the subway, which is hatched black, which we then define as the nested view. And here you see the apartment as a space you are inhabiting and experiencing, which we define as the experiential view. So these are the six views that we established. and the distortion happening in experiential views are a result of reconciling the nesting of each fragment to another, into another, which also led to a dreamlike quality of the spaces.
So the set becomes a way, a platform for us to test the design of projected realities. And it allows us to develop this consistent method of constructing projected realities in order to make a whole catalog and variety of these objects. So this idea kind of came from the developed surface essay, which was done by Robin Evans. And he discusses how objects don't really have an allegiance to a specific surface or an orientation. And he frames this as a problem he encountered while creating drawings of unfolded interior elevations, as you can see on the right. He had difficulty representing how the representing the projection of furniture because they didn't have an allegiance to a wall or surface. And what he starts to frame as a problem is what we took on to investigate through the design of projected realities. So we're trying to design objects that have an allegiance to a specific view and can start to reconcile different viewpoints. So these objects can exist in two different realities and align to multiple viewpoints as they start to reevaluate and reframe spaces differently in both the experiential and the nested views. So we're not really investigating the architecture per se, but it's more about how spaces can be perceived differently through virtual objects that have architectural implications.
We also looked at Silva Levine's essay, Architecture in Extremis, and she talked about how objects within a space can start to become architecture. And she describes the idea of hoarding, and if an interior houses enough objects, those objects actually become architecture as they define the space around them in the same way walls and enclosures would. And for us, the objects are beyond just furnitures. They can be complete or partial spaces, architectural elements, or like many other things. And since the projected realities that we created are contained and floating within the space due to the distortion, they are very much like objects, but only start to become architecture and define spaces once aligned with specific views. So we tested and experimented with a variety of these objects and how they can influence the perception of the original spaces. And this is the collection of objects that we created. Initially, we worked with objects that have program implications to confuse the boundary between work and leisure, but then we moved on to experimentations of objects that are more geometric and can frame views. So while making these objects, we made several discoveries and became more interested in manipulating the distortion so that an object can work with multiple spaces and can provide different spatial implications for both views. So then we tested more objects like this. This is an object to be placed into the apartment. It makes a simple mullion in the space. However, what we found interesting is that since the mullion is so close to the camera, that object doesn't have to be complete. And as this object is specific to one viewer, we start to use a view cone to cut objects so that what is outside the view cone doesn't have to be constructed. And what is hidden in the experiential view can potentially be something for the nested view. Of course, projected realities can also be a group of objects. In the experiential view of the office, these objects become partitions to create different conditions between desks. And some of the cuts are actually results of aligning the objects in the nested view, which is this one. So being seen from the apartment, objects on the desks are aligned and patched together like a puzzle, forming like a wall with cutouts. So the next drawing reviews how this object is constructed by two viewpoints. The objects with red outlines are original objects before distortion that only work with the office view, but by manipulating the projection, the object can work with both the office and the apartment view. And that's a zoomed in version of the distortion.
So this is an object that can be placed within the subway set. In the experiential view of the subway, it becomes another kind of window or opening that creates a new version of the view within a view, and it reveals back in a view back into the cityscape of Midtown. But from the bar, the object then turns around into a threshold, creating a new opening with stairs that hints at a new kind of space. So what we found interesting with this is how a flat virtual surface is made out of volume. And we also found interesting parts of the objects that were more misaligned when the viewer started to step out of the view cone, as you can see here. And this view kind of shows how we created this distorted object that starts to reconcile two different objects into a singular one. And it also creates a new object in each of the views. And this last object is one for the bar space. This object frames views. So in this view, it frames the window that's looking into the subway, while from the nested view from the park, the same object starts to frame the bar instead. So there were sculpture aspects of these pieces that you can see as it's viewed from the perspective where it's not fixed, it starts to become misaligned with the space. And basically throughout the semester, we spent a lot of time designing this set and also designing objects that can start to reconcile multiple viewpoints within our set. And it became like a platform for us to experiment and place these virtual objects within frame spaces to reevaluate to how they're perceived and experienced differently through these projected realities. So this whole project for us kind of became an experiment where we started to test and explore different methods. But in the beginning, we didn't really have an answer to what end. So it became a way for us to question, speculate through the production and experimentation. So because we had this set built up, it allowed us to just keep experimenting with the project to make new discoveries. And a lot of the ideas we talked about didn't really come near the beginning of the project, but rather came up more to the end as we started to rigorously like experiment with this. And even after finals, we had the ability to take this project even further based on the discussion we had during our final presentation.
So even though we are exploring architecture as something that are both physical and virtual, we initially plan to represent both as physical models that you can touch and that are captured by the camera for each fragment. And however, once we start to step out of the constraint of working with physical cameras and consider the idea that these objects are not only created in the virtual realm and also can be represented virtually, we realize that there are opportunities to create something that doesn't have to abide by physical rules. So then we decided to take this project a step further. And this, what we're showing here is the texture of object being animated. And in the next view, the strips are animated to unify the objects patched together in the secondary view. So the moving texture and the materiality can facilitate the perception of objects as well.
Another thing we realized was to move this project further after finals was the idea of having multiple viewpoints, because before we had a single viewpoint in each set, and that wasn't really representative of the human view because you're never really standing in one space specifically to view something. So we realized that these objects start to misalign when stepped out of the perspective, which is interesting, but we wanted to see how it can start realign to multiple viewpoints as someone moves through the space. So we created a version of the objects with two moving viewpoints to show how the objects can start to constantly change to match multiple viewpoints and not just one. So these views start to become the things that construct the object as they become active in this version and not passive. And as these projected realities can start to reconcile and align to multiple viewpoints, this project started to act as kind of a provocation to see how virtual objects create different implications for multiple viewers. So this kind of shows the new version where the object experience in the space is constantly changing to align to the view of a person moving within the space. It kind of compares differently to the animation show previously, where it's evident that the object was misaligned when stepped out of frame. This is it showing it in the nested view. So kind of even after finals, because we had this platform, this project still allowed us to experiment with our ideas. And this became important to us because we're trying to speculate on the future where the architecture we design can start to become virtual or these like virtual objects. And we discovered through like experimenting with the project, how the idea of multiple viewpoints can talk to the idea of multiple user experience in the virtual realm. And currently like ideas of AR and VR still remain more like a singular experience, as we mentioned before. But with projected realities, we can start to have communal viewing, alluding to the ideas about like society of the spectacle and the Walter Pritchler that we had in the beginning.
Yeah, so even though the project isn't oriented towards the technical aspects of creating the virtual, as like the actual production of the virtual architecture won't just be done by drawing projection lines, we are more hoping to provoke how conceptually people can start to think about the design of architecture once it becomes both physical and virtual, and using the view as something that is active rather than passive. So projected realities allow architecture to become exclusive to two moving inhabitants or a specific number of them, implying different spatial conditions for each. And the experiments of the objects also made us interested in the question of what does the exclusive objects mean to people other than the specific viewers if they are communal to everyone. And we're still looking at ways of how a project can question this new kind of architecture, which acts as a synthesis of both the fixed and projected realities, and also rethinking the boundary between the physical and the virtual and the possibilities of both. Thank you.
I have a lot of ideas about this project, and I was really hoping I wouldn't be the one who talked first, because some of those ideas, because this was so well presented, and there's such a range of works that provoke me and my own personal interest in so many ways, that I can't help but have lots of ideas about where else this could go. And that was alluded to in this presentation, that you have a very fluid process here. But I'm gonna table all of that for a minute and try to ask you a question, which is a really, I think, a broad question. But what is your attitude about the digital image, given one, that by going remote, you went from a plan of having physical models to being virtual in a different way than you had been previously thinking about it. But I'm trying to wrap my head around whether you see the digital image as a key currency here, right? And are we looking at a representation of architecture, or are you treating the digital image as a work of architecture? And is that part of your thinking, or has your understanding of the image changed theoretically throughout this project?
Yes. Initially, we would say the digital image would be just a representation of architecture. But I think towards the end, we think there's a much more possibility with digital image just being digital architecture itself, because now we're talking about like a smart object that can change and adapt to moving viewpoints. Yeah.
Yeah, with some of the references we saw, like with some like VR, AR movies, we thought that they were more about this like new information overlay that was just kind of as these images and like flat surfaces that would just be in front of our eyes. But because we're developing these as, well, they were supposed to be physical objects that represented virtual, but now they're virtual objects within these virtual spaces
that
we have. It starts to talk about the virtual, not as just virtual images, but as architecture itself. It has physical implications, even though you would see it as just a visual thing.
Yes. Yeah, that's where I think, you know, the idea of the frame is super important, right? And that's one of the salient features of all of your new elements, is that they deal with the frame. But when we consume a digital image outside of an AR context, we see the frame. And so I think there's a way to view your presentation in reverse and have some discourse about the role of the frame, not just in the spaces, but at the boundary of the image, right? So we're looking at one right now where there's a frame within the frame, which is within the frame of my Zoom. And I think there is an opportunity there to play with that, right? To say, if you're recognizing that now these are, this is an architectural image, then you get to have agency over where and how the frame is played with. So, you know, there might be places where the rectangular frame is set in so that you can actually let the element fuse with the picture plane of our screen. There was one a few frame, can you go back a few slides? Keep going, that one. Well, maybe back one more. Yeah, that one on the left there, right? Like that to me is a really exciting moment where the invisible frame of the image is really in play with the element itself. Just to make sure that my what I'm saying is making sense to you. I don't at all mean to take up time here, but this is I feel like this is one of those places where there are many ways we could drill into your project and talk shop about the virtual digital details without betraying your overall and really thoughtful concept. So thank you.
I had some comments. First of all, thank you. Beautiful presentation and beautifully told story about your interrogation. I had a couple questions for you as well. And similar to Carl's comments, one was, have you thought about putting this together into pieces in the same way that Hitchcock put his sets together into a total viewpoint so that we imagine that in fact it all ties together when in fact it's just a series of sets? And the second question is, I love the idea of objects, but I also feel that you might, and I'm just curious if you've explored these on a different scale, because as we start to see them and you start to mutate them, they start to take on, for me, a whole different meaning from what maybe the original object was. So if you could talk about that a little bit. Be great. Thank you.
So with the idea of scale, we did have some tests where at first some of them were more object-based, such as like chairs and tables, but later we started to reconstruct like entire spaces, as you can see with some of these images over here. But because we had to have them within the frame of this fragment that we had, they were more or less smaller, more interior spaces. I think potentially they can start having different larger scales where they become much more architectural. But we didn't play with that possibility yet. I think the set allows us to do that if we were to take it on a step further. And sorry, what was your first question again?
The first question was whether or not you had explored or thought about the idea of putting these together in the same way that Hitchcock put all his sets together into a piece so that what is maybe the virtual reality becomes more a complete virtual reality, I guess, versus objects in space.
Yeah, I think like right now we have these fragments that we just chose, and while they do represent a physical space, they aren't actually like straight representations of the physical world. I think with that, maybe these virtual, if we start to place these virtual realities not in this physical set, but within like our realities, they can start constructing like a new cohesive experience of virtual reality. It's not just an object that, you, like you said, can be a whole view. I think with this set, it just allows us to test these in six different viewpoints, but, and that was difficult because as you started stepping out of the viewpoints, you can see where the subway ends or where the object is like cut, but that was just specific to this set. I think this method that we have constructing allows us to put it back into our physical world right now, and that allows us to create a more cohesive or seamless experience that's different from this one.
Great, thanks.
Yeah, I mean, I wanna also applaud you for just a really fascinating exploration. And I like the fact, you know, that you were testing ideas and kind of going back and questioning, you know, for example, okay, so what are we missing? Like, I thought it was a really important step that you made to realize, oh, our viewpoints are fixed. And therefore, what does it mean if we recognize that viewpoints are actually shifting, right, in relationship to the way in which the body moves, right? And so I think there's something really fascinating about your work in regards to the staticness of architecture and the movement of the body, at least in the physical real world. But what I think is interesting is that you're saying, no, actually, there's a dimension of architecture, and very much so, that deals with image and that deals with representation. And so I'm wondering what's at play in the work. And the reason I use the word play is I'm thinking precisely of Hitchcock, I'm thinking of theater, I'm thinking of, like, it's not just a set, it's a setting, and it becomes ground for play, performance, for event, right? And this is clearly what someone like Shumi in his Manhattan Transcripts, right, in a representational realm sort of sets up, right, as, you know, the drawing can be the mise-en-scene of something that has happened, could have happened, is happening. And so I'm wondering, and especially around the theme of like, what's, maybe what are the stakes for, you know, how this thing is actually inhabited virtually? Who's playing and what's at play here? I don't know if that makes any sense, but I mean that also in terms of, like, Hitchcock, right? Because what Hitchcock sets up, you know, is the event. There is something that has happened, and the whole point of it is to try to unravel the mystery, like, what happened. And you see this unraveling of the past in real time, which has then been recorded in a very, you know, in a kind of very fragmented, as you show in the set. So, you know, so if I am in the subway, in the apartment, in, like, what might, if you want to speculate further, and maybe this is relevant for what you, where you take the project, like what are the terms of play?
I'd like to build on that. One of the things that intrigued me, this image is a good one, and your last image is a good one, is that within this frame, there's a reality of all of these different experiences interacting, and there are the spaces in between. And especially in your last animation, where the people were walking and the objects were changing dynamically. I think one of the things that you didn't speak about, but which is very important to me when I view your beautiful presentation, are the spaces in between. Yeah. So part of the dynamic that you didn't talk about is how you're moving in between, and then it becomes closer to a lived experience in that you focus and move out of focus and focus and move out of focus, and the object is dynamically changing and becomes your anchor as you move from set to set.
Yeah, I also think that's quite exciting, right? Like, as you were presenting, I was wondering about the concept of poche and thickness, and whether your objects could or would become thicker. And now, as Mabel and Sarah are talking about play and activities, I wonder if you might flip it, and instead of the white space between being thought of as the poche, all of your objects are the equivalent of poche. And what the between is the space that could be programmed, not as a transition necessarily, but as something completely other. And that's actually the live charged space that you could spend time programming, designing, considering. And that doesn't undermine the elements slash objects that you've already made. It actually charges them even more with some other burden, right? Like their reason for being initially was geometric, perceptual, projective, but now they can be in play with or respond to something completely other.
Yeah, I think like we've already adopted like this way of designing something that is out of the view for the objects already. But yeah, responding to like the idea of like events and like other programs between just the physical set, I think that method can be applied to the design of the set as well to fill in those gaps in between.
Yeah, I feel like, I mean, we described this as a set, but definitely like an idea or a question that we had also was about this, like what is the in-between space and do these sets actually physically occupy, or is it just a representation of spaces that would exist in our city? I think like it could be both. Like, I feel like the unraveling for us became like you're in, or for us, like the experiential view, you're never aware that these spaces are actually distorted and fragmented in the way that they are. But once you step out of the view and you see the objects that are distorted, that as distorted and the set as distorted, is when you realize that, that this isn't just an object that has like a backside and something else going on. I feel like even with the rear window reference that we had in all the camera viewpoints, like, and the specific scenes that Alfred Hitchcock shot, like you're never aware that this is like just a set. It seems seamless, but then like with the plan that we show, actually these spaces are fragmented, but seem cohesive or seamless in a way that's framed by the camera and the moving cameras. Mm-hmm. So I feel like definitely like right now we didn't really have anything specifically for this in-between space, but like you said, it became a way for us to activate like a new type of program or space within these existing spaces. That could be something completely other or alien to what we have right now.
Yeah, I just want to add one point about that, particularly about rear window, which I've actually taught, because I think it's an amazing, exactly for all the reasons that you, the way in which it draws. But I also think it's the rear space, not the front face. It's not about the facade, the public, what is being projected, but what happens behind, right? You know, and it's about property and propriety, like what's appropriate. Should he be looking? Should he not be looking? Should they be, you know? And so it really sort of toys with the ways in which things are structured. And it feels like you're playing also in that space of the ways in which we're supposed to perceive or not perceive, structure what or not. And that's why I'm thinking, oh, there's something really happening here, but what? And I feel like that's the stakes in your project or the things that aren't yet fully articulated, developed. You have the apparatus, but I'm wondering how you put it into play.
There's several wonderful ideas in your project, but one in particular that interests me is if you go to the interior shot, you have exterior views and you have interior views that are affected by these created objects. Now, go to your objects that you created. There's a
catalog.
The catalog of objects that you created. Okay, here, this one. So some of them, go back to the first one, the first catalog, the first drawing that showed further back, the one that shows the spaces, the objects as openings. Go back, one more, back. Well, there's some objects that look like openings to another space. They're basically interior objects. No, this in the catalog ones.
Like these ones?
Well, this will do. In this particular one, you have objects that are representational. A lot of them, the chairs, we know what they are, and they're placed inside of a space. So they kind of have, they represent things and we know what they are. And go further into your abstractions that we started to create, like the ones on the left, these start to become, some of these become spaces and framing from one space to another, especially on the right-hand side. But then continue, go next slide. When you started to abstract these things, they became more abstract. They were not representational anymore. They set up their own world. And when you started to place them in interior views, they set up kind of sculptural tension. But when you set it on the exterior views, they have a different
relationship
and aesthetic. So how do you explain the relationship of the object from interior to exterior, or should they be the same object, or viewing them from different interior to exterior and walking around them? What were your ideas about that?
Well, with some of the objects we had, initially had them so then there's still objects that you see within one view, but as you start walking around, like you said, have like sculptural implications. That was like one like idea for us, I guess. But after, I guess that kind of rose a question of these viewpoints aren't actually fixed for us. And then what can happen when they start aligning to multiple viewpoints? So this could be one where the backside of these objects can have like a different sculptural implication, or as you start walking around the space, this object remains relatively still. So it's, you don't see it changing, but they start to change to align to your eyes as you're moving throughout the space. Like we did, like the experiments we did after finals was kind of testing these ideas of these objects that were constantly changing. I think there is something about like the backside of these objects where you start to view them out of frame and what that can imply for these spaces.
May I jump in with a comment and question? The other critics, I was also just really impressed and stimulated by the presentation. I think that the collection of drawings and the intellectual foundation of the project were really amazing. And what I think I was most impressed by was the kind of the journey that you took us on as you kind of set up this system and you kept on building onto it and complexifying it. You know, where you started out with the kind of the viewpoints and the views, then looking at the space, the frame, then bringing in the objects, animating the objects, and then later in the presentation, all of a sudden the human figure appears. And so I really, really, really enjoyed and was impressed by that journey. And I also kind of wonder when do you stop? And I guess I was also thinking about what could be kind of the next steps. And because I really liked earlier in the presentation also the way in which you situated your project in Midtown and really thought about it as this kind of network. And in a way, I couldn't help but while watching the presentation and thinking about that network, how it's really very similar to what we're experiencing today, that we are all looking into these viewpoints into other people's spaces. And so I in a way kind of see your project maybe as a model for thinking about how to build up our lives in the one that we're living right now, where it's all kind of virtual, but yet we have the window into these other spaces. And so I guess what I wanted to ask about was really about the human and the social aspect and the human and social potential of your project. I think about Rear Window, and maybe slightly different than Mabel, but I think sort of building on some of those ideas, I think one of my readings of a Rear Window is like kind of the responsibility that we have to others and the potential for a shared social world. Jeffries is looking at everyone else, but he doesn't necessarily think people are looking at him. But then there's the question of what to do with Miss Lonely Hearts as she's contemplating suicide and so on. And so I think that what I see in the project is a system in which you can continue to add these other layers. And I'm wondering, given the hints of the human beings at the end of your project, what is the potential for this as a way to think about new social networks in addition to those of just the objects and the views that you've shown?
I mean, definitely the idea of the person or people in the space came a little afterwards for us. And that's why we were specific about not adding people into the images until the very end with the multiple viewpoints. But I think like you said, we have the idea of the window framing two different physical spaces, like the subway and the apartment or the office and the apartment, but potentially like with these virtual objects, they can really be anything you want. So maybe the objects themselves start to become, like you said, like a window to another space or to another opening. And that has like implications for people as they become interconnected in ways that the physical wouldn't let them connect. The visual or these virtual objects let people become virtually connected while physically distant, or like kind of what's happening right now, I guess. At first the idea of these objects were that maybe they kind of confuse the boundary between work and leisure or imply different programs and spaces that aren't supposed to have that program, or create this new level of privacy or like public with these virtual objects, I think can be a potential, or just like interconnectivity in the virtual realm through these objects as well.
One of the things that I'm finding fascinating in this image and in many of your images, as you got deeper and deeper into your exploration, is the tension between what I call representational, very realistically evocative, and between the increasing abstraction, and as you, that's part of what makes this project exciting to me, and an image like this, is the tension between the representational and the abstract. And I haven't heard you talk about it yet, if either of you could speak to that a little bit.
I think like the biggest representation method we had initially was the idea of having this physical set, but with it moving into the virtual, like one thing we were thinking about was how to begin to represent these in a way that doesn't require the physical model. And that was through this idea of like setting up this drawing technique where we have the physical represented through like more modest like line work, but then the virtual becomes represented as more of these textured and realistic renderings in a way that might seem different from how it's like. We had the idea of having photorealistic or hyperrealistic renders of these fragments, but we came to this idea of representation because we thought it had like that distinction between the physical and the virtual within a picture that's just shown as virtual.
Right, so this is all virtual. I'm looking at this and seeing it as all virtual. And I love the idea that you're starting to consider that you're moving through this virtual space, but within the way I'm looking at it, within this virtual space, you've decided to make different grammar, visual languages, and different, almost a hierarchy of different forms of representation. And so you have, as you say, you've selected one form of representation for objects that you consider you're abstracting a realistic image, but one that is very easily readable to somebody. They can relate it to a bunch of things that they see, and one that's far more abstract, that you're looking into that object and you're not layering so many other experiences onto it. You're more immediately attached to that object itself and what it is. And I think those different layers of, you've made these decisions of different virtual, simultaneous different virtual experiences all in the same frame. And that I think that has a lot of potential richness.
Well, we are running out of time, so we're going to have to stop there. But Diana and Claudia, thank you for an amazing project, an amazing year. Congratulations. We're going to move on to the next group. While we get organized here for a second, we just wanted to ask if the jury members could just quickly introduce themselves. So if you guys could just go around and do that, that would be awesome.
I'll start. I'm Maddie Burke-Bigelon. I'm a principal at Gensler.
My name is Frank Giswaldi. I'm a practicing architect, an associate principal at Studios Architecture, and former teacher at.
Hi,
welcome
I'm
back,
Amy.
Frank.
Oh, hi, I'm Joel Wilson. I teach at Columbia.
I'll go. I'm Carl Lestrito. I'm the graduate program director of RISD's MArc program, and I'm in Providence, where I will be forever.
Mm-hmm. Hello, my name is Sam Schmitz. I'm a project architect, project manager at FX Collaborative, and I'll give you my 5-second soundbite for the last project since I didn't speak. I would challenge you to be very rigorous about how you jump between all these very juicy and buzzwords of representation and abstraction and virtual. I think as you move forward, you'll be able to probably critique and have a, you know, like challenge yourself on how you jump between all these words and how they apply to your project, because they are buzzwords. And I challenge you as you move forward in your profession to, you know, look at how you use those terms and how they get applied to how you use them.
Hi, I'm Georgine Theodore, and I'm professor at New Jersey Institute of Technology, where I direct the Master of Infrastructure Planning program. I'm also a principal and co-founder of Interborough Partners.
Hi, my name is Suzanne Milne. I'm a principal at 1100 Architect. I don't teach. I don't have any aspirations to teach, but I always love to come to Pratt and be part of these reviews. So thank you. And thank you for a really beautiful project that you showed. I have lots of other comments, but we're running out of time. So
thank you. If you think it's a comment, you could always put it in the chat for the students.
Oh, okay. Thanks for that.
Hi, so I'm Sarah Caples, and
I'm Everardo Jefferson. I'm from Caples Jefferson Architects.
Great. I think we got everyone, right? Thank you all so much for coming and spending the time with us today. We are going to pass the virtual mic over to Michael and Philip for the next project.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Abby. Thank you for hosting this, and thank you to all our guests for joining us. So my name is Michael Su, and my teaching partner, Philip, I think your mic is still off.
Hi, Philip Bowman. Good morning.
So usually we do the introduction for our studio in the context of the presentation you'll see. But this time, due to the nature of this interface, we've asked our students actually to take the burden of presenting our studio. So go ahead, Anthea and Monica. Thank you.
Well, first, I just want to make sure everybody can see the screen properly.
Yep.
Okay, great. Okay. So good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. My name is Anthea Valoria.
And I'm Monica Legat.
We are here to present our work for our degree project studio called Exigent Manila. Our studio professors are Philip Bauman and Michael Su, and our HMS professor is David Kim. To start, this is an image of Daniel Burnham's unrealized plan for Manila, dated 1905. The Spanish-American War had just ended a few years earlier, and Burnham planned to develop Manila into the capital of American territories in the East. Back then, Manila had been known for its extensive naturally protected bay and its many waterways and canals, including the 25-kilometer long Pasig River, which bisects Burnham's plan here. In fact, Manila had been considered the Venice of the East. 80 years after Burnham's unrealized plan, and after two decades of enduring massive inequality and neglect under the corrupt leadership of Ferdinand Marcos, the famous Three Fateful Days in Manila of 1986 brought about a people-powered revolution that saw millions of Filipinos march in the streets and finally ousted Marcos from power. This revolution was supposed to bring about a new era for the Philippines, but 30 years later, the inequality and neglect persist. Today, Manila is notorious for the encompassing scale and diverse variation of its architecture, which range from vast informal settlements along the city's margins to gleaming steel and glass towers in massive gated communities like Rockwell and Bonifacio Global City. The continuing inequality and neglect must be seen to be believed. Here, the informal community of Baseco is actually planned to be left intact in order to provide ready labor for the adjacent city of Pearl, a literal island of wealth and privilege.
Our design studio views the myriad design problems associated with rapid urbanization, such as cultural disintegration, resource scarcity, infrastructural overload, erosion and militarization of public spaces, rising coastlines, and the ever-present housing shortage have escalated in both scale and complexity to degrees well beyond those formerly addressable by architects. As such, we believe novel and ever more scalable, adaptable, and interdisciplinary design strategies are urgently required at every stage of the design process. Specifically, we believe such strategies entail simultaneously designing for both the architecture of the city, its visible physical hardware and the urbanity of the city, and its invisible ephemeral software.
The studio's production process starts by collaging physical models. We take formal figural precedents and sample, cut, fold, and extrapolate them to create something of our own. The resulting physical models are translated into drawings,
which are then contextualized and realized into Manila's dense and super varied urbanity.
Here's a 30-second sneak peek into the resulting studio production. This brings us to our own project.
As you can imagine, this was a production we had to undertake just before the lockdown. So we were very glad the students were able to produce this quantity of work just in time.
Our degree project is titled The Living Museum. The Living Museum is a new museum typology that serves as an innovative space for representing every community in the Philippines, especially those of marginal, usually invisible, impoverished, informal communities. The Living museum will represent these communities through the preservation and practice of intangible cultural heritage.
The Philippines is an archipelago or string of 7,641 islands in southeastern Asia between the South China Sea and the Pacific Ocean. The country has 17 regions with 81 provinces, and there are 182 native languages. Its living traditions are dynamic and varied. As children of Filipino immigrants with families both from Manila, we have been immersed in traditional Filipino culture. However, we have noticed its lack of representation both in the US and in the Philippines itself. We use this studio as an opportunity to address this problem. UNESCO defines intangible cultural heritage as traditions or living expressions inherited from our ancestors and passed on to our descendants. Examples prevalent in the Philippines are oral traditions and expressions, performing arts, social practices, rituals, and festive events, knowledge and practices concerning nature and the universe, and traditional craftsmanship. Intangible cultural heritage is traditional, contemporary, and living. It exists in those in the present who continue these practices. However, a culture obsessed with globalization has caused the loss of practice and knowledge of traditional culture. Recognition from the community is key in the safeguarding and continuation of intangible cultural heritage.
The existing museums in the Philippines do not adequately represent Filipino intangible cultural heritage. Typically, the museum typology has visitors learn through displays, creating a curated experience where there is a strict relationship between object and viewer. The past is romanticized as an isolated object which does not change. Museums should not be a place of isolation or an exclusive way of experiencing culture. Often, museums take the form of confined colossal structures run by the wealthy members of society. They are exclusive, catering to the educated and the elite. They do not represent the majority that live in the densest informal areas of Metro Manila. According to forms of informality, morphology, and visibility of informal settlements, major urban infrastructure such as railways, freeways, and large power or sewer lines often have easements or buffer zones that become major sites of informal encroachment. People with such living conditions need to be represented. Currently, there is an ongoing project to create a 36-kilometer-long subway for Metro Manila by 2025. When choosing a site, we looked at two subway stations in Quezon City. This drawing from the fall semester looks at the area around Quezon Avenue Station. The orange indicates the few public spaces, and the blue indicates the surrounding informal settlements.
This drawing looks at the area near East Avenue Station, where V. Luna Avenue acts as a main artery into suburban fabric. It connects three informal settlements together.
This drawing examines the two main public spaces between the Quezon Avenue Station and the East Avenue Station. They're both adjacent to informal settlements. Here, the informal settlements encroach upon the public spaces instead of being separated from them by the existing high walls. After researching, we chose Barangay Piñahan as our site, located between the Quezon Avenue Station and East Avenue Station. Barangay Piñahan is a district in Quezon City. It's comprised of government institutions and hospitals, gated public areas, schools, suburban residences, and three main informal settlement clusters. There are about 3,000 young adults and only about 130 people above the age of 80. The youth cannot continue living traditions because they are influenced by globalization and have few elderly to pass on traditions.
Our chosen site in Barangay Piñahan is the ideal place for this museum because it addresses three existing conditions: a cultural museum, mid-rise government buildings, and an informal settlement. The Museum of Filipino Culture on BIR Road is surrounded by 8-foot-high gates, making it inaccessible to the public. The informal settlement is separated from the museum by 8 to 10-foot-high walls and is only accessible by NIA Road, a street which branches from the major artery of East Avenue. The East Triangle community is hidden in the shadows of mid-rise towers. There are no community centers within close proximity. Due to these isolating conditions and the lack of public space, the informal settlers are forced to only communicate amongst themselves. By opening up the empty lot and the existing museum to the informal community, the Living Museum will create an accessible connection to East Avenue.
Rather than having a monumental structure that is detached from society, what if a museum could integrate into the fabric of the community? The Living Museum will reinvent the museum typology as a dynamic and immersive space that branches into the East Triangle informal community.
The structural and programmatic precedents we looked at were the Centre Pompidou and the Fun Palace because of their dynamic and multifunctional nature. The formal precedents we looked at were the Sheikh Abdullah Salem Cultural Center in Kuwait and the UCLA Chiller Plant for their connectivity to site and display of mechanical systems. We began to use the idea of mechanical systems as a way of creating breathable circulation. The Living Museum integrates systematic connectivity and breathable ability by collaging patterns of mechanical systems at different scales to create a flow across the site through the practice of intangible cultural heritage. The existing grid of the site determines how the parts are oriented and shifted along parallel bands.
This model is a 3D translation of the collage of mechanical systems. The mechanical systems become volumetric spaces and landscape is introduced. Trusses were added to hang the roofs over long spanning spaces. The trusses extend to connect the Living Museum to the surrounding existing structures, such as the mid-rise government buildings and the garage of the Museum of Filipino Culture. The True Living Museum uses dynamic shifting to link the once isolated informal East Triangle community to the rest of Metro Manila by overriding the inadequate existing museums and reviving the practice of intangible cultural heritage.
The roof plan shows how the Living Museum becomes a connector between the informal settlement and East Avenue. Its lines of structure reach out into the city. The museum complex is accessible from both the informal and the formal edges through shifting buildings that create a flow across the site. The different parts of the museum are connected by a continuous underground system that transitions the external landscape and public spaces into the internal programs. Five zones of program flow from the informal settlement in the east to the existing museum in the west. There is the agricultural zone, performance zone, craftsmanship zone, market zone, and live work zone. The agricultural zone consists of a community farm that grows native crops in the center and surrounding softscape area that has potential to become growing areas. The performance zone consists of dance studios, classrooms, and storytelling rooms. The subterranean performance spaces consist of theaters and an archive. The craftsmanship zone consists of studios and workshops. And within the berm's lower level is a gallery space lit by light wells. The market and food zone consists of a market selling foods cultivated from the agricultural zone and stalls selling traditional crafts. The berm's lower level has the communal kitchen and food museum. The residential zone located in the existing museum consists of improved residences for those living in the East Triangle informal community as well as administration. Housing can be accessed from the lower levels by a ramp.
This section cuts through the existing Museum of Filipino Culture and shows how it is integrated into the Living Museum. The existing Museum of Filipino Culture is transformed with more public spaces and skylights that let in more natural light. The original floor slabs are transformed to create more continuous spaces. A portion of the existing Museum of Filipino Culture is used to provide improved houses for the residents of the informal East Triangle community. And between the housing units are open areas for gathering and even a community garden. And here is an interior perspective looking into where the improved houses are. Adjacent to the housing are the offices and administration where the inhabitants of the East Triangle community can work to run the whole living museum. Across from the offices and administration building is an occupiable berm that can be accessed in the subterranean level. This contains the gallery that exhibits traditional arts and crafts. Adjacent to the gallery are the crafts workshops where people can learn to create traditional arts and crafts. The lower craft workshops overlook the art gallery where their creations can be displayed. This section is cut perpendicular to the Museum of Filipino Culture and cuts through the agricultural fields. This structure functions as an exterior shell in which smaller stalls can sell the traditional arts and crafts created from the adjacent workshops. Underneath is another occupiable berm in which a food museum and communal kitchen uses the traditional crops grown from the fields. The berm is terraced to cool the surfaces and control water runoff. And here is an exterior perspective of the berms and shows how they're used for agricultural purposes. Across from the berm is the performance zone. The west part of the performance zone has classrooms and studios where people can learn traditional dances and theater. There is also an archive where people's oral traditions can be permanently recorded. The east part of the performance zone has theaters and storytelling rooms in which traditional dances and theatrical productions can be performed and where personal stories can be shared.
We strongly believe the informal communities best represent and maintain Filipino culture than any existing museum.
And the Living Museum is the architectural means to help them do so. Thank you.
Well, thank you for this this presentation, and looks like it was. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Looks like it was an incredible journey, starting out with the kind of the larger investigation of Manila, and using that analysis of the city, and then also building on your own. Personal cultural histories of the Philippines to come up with this project of the Living Museum. And I think that the ambition of the project is really wonderful, which is to rethink the program of a particular building, the traditional museum, and to use it as a vehicle to address some larger cultural, social, and sort of physical conditions that you see present in this place. And so I really applaud the premise of the project. And it's a lot of work to review in such a short period of time. And I thought maybe as an opening question, I would ask a more general question, really about how you have framed the projects before perhaps we get into a deeper discussion about the building itself, which I know that there's a lot to talk about. But I guess one of the things that I'm wondering about is, you gave these precedents of different museums, and I believe that a lot of the precedents were really looking at the physical and the structural. But I know that in recent years, there have been many new and interesting models of institutions that do more than what the institution is typically done. Like it's
bringing in new programs, new modes of inhabitation to address questions bigger than the institution itself. And that's what I see you doing here. I'm thinking a little bit about, like, say, the rethinking, David Aja's rethinking of the library in London, so that it's not so much about books anymore, but it's really about connecting people to resources, strengthening people's position in society, and so on. So some of the questions that are running through my mind in the project is how, with the when you tackle the typology of the museum, and where you're really looking to kind of make visible and to integrate these isolated groups, how do you really tackle the question of putting people on display, and really in a way undoing the normative function of the museum, which is to like have a collection and then put it onto public view. So I guess one of the things I'd love to hear from you all is how you address that in the project. So really, you know, not in a way kind of continuing with the inequitable treatment of this group by putting them on display. So that's one question I have. And then the second is, I'm really curious, it might have been a question of time, but I think once you have this framework, I think a project like this would be really interesting to explore maybe from different lenses besides the structural, which you really emphasized in your presentation, but really more through the temporal and through also through ownership. Because I think that the one view that you showed where you have the housing and people are hanging their clothes on the inside, I think what you're doing is you're kind of upending you're contesting the kinds of normative relationships of say, like public and private and land tenure. And so I'm curious how you played through those. So yeah, the one question is really about the nature of the museum and putting a group on display, how you tackled that. And then second, what are the different ways that you can play through some of the, like say the less permanent aspects of the project or the less visible aspects of the project, like about land ownership or about, you know, what's opened and closed, who gets to be where, that kind of thing.
I think to answer the first question, we try to get away from the usual model of museum by focusing on community type programs. We also mentioned that we felt like the museum could also be a type of community center. So it would be more about sharing performative activities rather than completely putting people or objects on display, which is why we looked into intangible cultural heritage as the subject for the museum, because we felt that would be a good connector to informal communities and just people in general.
And I guess answering the question about ownership. So we wanted, because a lot of the public buildings in Metro Manila are like physically closed off, or they have like these high gates and these high walls, and they are not, so it's hard for people to actually go in them. And even though they're made for the people, they don't actually function for the people they're made for. So for here, we wanted to have our living museum to be as accessible and porous as possible, especially to the East Triangle community, especially since we want them to have the access to the main road, which is East Avenue, where they have a lot of amenities that the informal sellers don't have direct access to. In terms of ownership, You know, we wanted it to be, because also in the perspective that you mentioned, in informal communities, since they are so dense, everybody is very socially, they are very close to one another, and each, it's almost like everybody is like a family within that community. So we still wanted to continue to have that within our museum, just provide them with like a better living conditions, but still preserve the open social connections that they have.
Yeah, I think that with a project like this, you're doing, you know, three or four times the amount of work that one would do in a kind of a building project, because you're working with the kind of the regional and the urban scale and the building itself. And I think that, so it's just provocations that when you're working to tackle something with this complexity, I think it would be really interesting for you to use some of your skills as architects to engage with some of these other invisible aspects of the project, like, you know, who curates it? Who actually chooses which groups get to be in there? Who, how do you decide who gets a unit in the housing? How do you decide when it's open and closed? I think the project really sets up a great framework on which you could layer those other aspects of the project that would allow you to engage the questions of inclusion and exclusion that you initially described at the beginning. So I think it's a really strong framework in which to do that.
Yeah, I mean, I would, you know, sort of maybe add to Georgine's comments and say, I think, you know, this is a really fascinating project. And I think you took on some really important critical questions about culture, cultural representations, and the spaces in which that happens. And I can't believe you found this site. Basically, you know, after your introduction of the larger studio, and talked about the challenges of Manila, right? The inequalities, the, you know, the kind of city that a neoliberal global economy is making, who's included and who's left out. I mean, I really salient, smart observations and foundation, I think, for a really good studio. And then you just find this site with a museum with, like, you know, development on it, and then, you know, an informal settlement essentially adjacent. So I think the site is really potent in terms of you know, what it sort of offered you. And I love the overall direction of what you're talking about: food culture, craft, performance. But I want to go back to something that you pointed out and kind of maybe the underpinnings of the studio, which had to do with scalable and adaptable. And it seems like what you've made is a large megastructure. And I'm wondering what clues might have been offered by the scale of informality about precisely the relationships, the families, the social relationships that form, that might have tempered the mega and maybe brought it down to a set of maybe tactical moves that could be sort of engaging. And I see them in moments in the project, but I'm wondering if this idea of even mechanical, breathable infrastructure perhaps was a thing, or even looking at the Centre Pompidou, you know, sort of pushed into the megastructure or the fun pushed into that, when in fact, maybe another kind of tactic is embedded in the project that have to do with a slightly different scale, or things that are scalable and adaptable. Because I feel that it almost dominates the site in a way that the kind of museum does when I look at the site plan and the scale of the site plan.
I mean, now you guys are going to answer, but I would definitely second that. I think that there's maybe an opportunity lost in terms of trying to do something that's at smaller scale, moving in and out of this museum might create something more interesting in terms of weaving the different functions together, which might also be more architectural incisions into this other structure that's there that could be really interesting. I think it's a great, very interesting project, but there's a couple of little bits that are not quite jiving, where I think this point about the scale is one of them.
I think we did try to address multiple scales, and I think that's especially visible in our earlier collage plan, which is in the top row of our set of images. Because we used this block of mechanical and scaled it to three sizes, one to be close to kind of the informal and the other one to deal with like a museum scale. I guess through, curating the project and cutting out parts, we might have potentially cut out too much. Maybe some of the smaller parts that could have connected better to the informal settlements.
I think it's a fascinating question, and I agree with, you know, Mabel phrased it so beautifully, and my sense is how Mabel frames it is directly in line with your ambitions. And what my suggestion is to think rhetorically about your representation and what it implicitly says about the role of the megastructure, right? So I know some of your best moves are in a collage perspective format in which the informal elements don't engage the megastructure directly. They engage the layers that are on top of the megastructure. So and this gets back to what Georgine asked way at the beginning, ownership and the temporal. My recommendation is that you increase the timescale of your representation. So if there is a megastructure and you're making an argument that that megastructure can be tactical, right? Like a really strange and difficult argument to make, I would say, show us the megastructure existing before anyone else, right? Imagine what that exists, how that exists 6 months, a year before anything else. And think about non-linear ways by which the museum could form, right? So the idea of settlements are not just about units and scale, but they're also about growth and inhabitation over time. So I think, you know, the solution might not be deleting the megastructure, but letting the megastructure age and be subject to activity. Maybe some of it gets destroyed or undone, and it's not constructed to support building. It's constructed in a kind of funhouse style activity to support activity. And some of that activity is built form. Some of that activity is grown form. Some of that activity is informal settlement. So I think the pieces are there. It's just about kind of re-choreographing the temporal story of how all of this comes together.
Well, I'm not sure I agree with the comments. If you look at your sections that you have, could you blow up the two sections that you have? The upper section, could you blow that up a little bit? Make it one image? Can that happen?
Yep, you can.
I mean, obviously, first of all, I think it's a wonderful project, and I think you guys did an incredible amount of work and thought through systems and brought all that kind of intellectual ideas to it. And I'm not opposed to architectural systems, megastructures, but and they work particularly here when you look at the section. I mean, look at the light coming through. Look at the courtyard. Look how it's broken up in the interior spaces. I think it's wonderful. I think there is potential for growth, for potential for small scale elements to accrue perhaps, but the courtyard lights, the skylights coming in, the way the spaces are broken up by light is just quite beautiful. The only issue I would have, if you go back to the facade, one of the drawings of the facade.
If you go back to your drawing with the multiple views.
The multiple views? So, you know, I'm listening to cultural artifacts and cultural issues, and then I look at the facade, and it's a wonderful abstraction of, I don't know. And I'm saying, this is, how did you generate that facade based on you know, 20th century aesthetics, or was it generated by something else? Because it's quite abstract. That's a question.
The facade is actually an abstraction of the mechanical systems that we were originally using to collage.
Okay.
So I'd like to sort of layer on a little bit to what Everett is talking about. I was thinking, I'm not familiar with Manila, but I'm familiar with cities in India and Africa that have similar disjunctures where compounds are cheek to jowl with informal settlements, and the inhabitant of the city experiences it in a very different way from the way we experience cities in the United States or Europe. And I think your megastructure, one of the things that I love is that it's given a public realm to everyone, to the people in the compounds and to the people in the informal settlements, and that it really does create a place where people can mix. And that's the ambition of that is really wonderful. And when I compare your megastructure to a megastructure like we have in New York City, like Hudson Yards, I think that your ambitions for the public to mix and to meet each other in varied, meaningful ways is really strong. And thank you for those ambitions and for thinking it through so carefully, and how some of these boundaries can be broken down and reintegrated so that there a broader access can occur.
Anthea and Monica, also, I just wanted to say as well that I commend the project, the ambition of the project, and the sort of number of issues you've taken on. You've certainly taken on some big and complex problems and issues, only some of which I would argue are architectural problems. The others, of course, fall into other buckets like political, economic, social. And I wonder if you're not, you know, proposing a kind of radical expansion of the role of the architect as a kind of, let's say, an advocate or a kind of, one would have to be a very kind of strong diplomat to connect across those buckets, to connect issues of space, to connect issues of urbanism and property, to issues of economics and representation and the kinds of issues around inclusivity and representation that you're trying to solve with architecture. So I wonder if there isn't just a little bit more that could be said up front in a presentation like this about what the role of the architect is and how that role needs to be radically kind of redefined, and sort of unapologetically state that you think, you know, that there is a way for that to happen. Because I think the first read would be to say of a project like this is like, it's taking on way too much. It's sort of unable to really fulfill the promise because it's almost a sort of, it's too much. But I think if you just put it out there and say, look, we understand the challenges, we understand the kind of the scale that we're taking on, and we think that based on projects that are happening all over the world where institutions are being questioned, where different groups are coming together in ways that are unprecedented in order to kind of diversify holdings within the museum, to open up the edges, the institutional edges, both physically and sort of otherwise, that there is precedent, there is promise, and we think that that there can be an acceleration of this type of trend or forward movement in the roles institutions are playing. We heard about the changing role of the library just a second ago from a juror, and I think there are other institutional types globally that you could have sort of brought into the conversation just to sort of provide some more traction to the what you're trying to achieve. That said, I also think you could have then, because once you do that, then you can say, okay, and here's the architectural sort of bucket that we'd like to investigate in a more tactical way. I think certainly you are interested in architecture, the two of you. You're interested in design, you're interested in structure, you're interested in mechanical systems, you're interested in site planning, and I think that's what you've been trained to do. And so I think you can then say, okay, we're gonna really drill down into these issues and show what we believe architecture can do to contribute to that larger meshwork of constituents that need to come together to really solve these complex problems. And there was a transition or a kind of inflection in your presentation for me where it was really important and it sort of went in a direction that I might have sort of shifted a little bit. And that point was where you really sensitively described the existing site conditions. You talked about the existing museum. You talked about the settlement, I think it was to the east, that was more of a kind of informal settlement. You talked about road access. You talked about orientation and entries and things that are that one could go in and actually diagram. I think what's missing are some diagrams that could identify in a very almost humble way, tactically what pieces of the site and pieces of the urban kind of network could have been changed in order to unlock potential. So for example, by dematerializing, let's say, the weight of the facade of the existing building and starting to add more transparency and porosity in a very literal way, reorienting roads, closing some roads and opening others, changing the orientation of the existing building, perhaps, so that it faces the settlement, the front door, or clear, you know, maybe erasing parts of the site and clearing, making clearings in the site to allow kind of potential to sort of grow into the site. In other words, almost cataloging those pinch points or those bottlenecks or those problem areas where architecture can have agency and actually very clearly sort of make some surgical modifications to these elements to suggest that by opening up some edges or sort of making some clearings or sort of shifting orientations, you're setting the table, as it were, for kind of for change to happen, right? Without necessarily all of the weight of your megastructure, if that's kind of what we're calling it at this point. I do think that there's a little bit of a, you know, just the amount of capital that would need to be infused into a project like to get the scale of this project to happen and the kind of almost overwhelming size and sort of weight of this project off the ground, it seems a little bit at odds with the premise of the project in the first place, which was seemed to be a little bit more of a bottom-up kind of emergent sort of idea about the institution of the museum or a new typology or a new critique of the institution of the museum. And it seems as if you went more with the Pompidou and less with the Fun Palace, right? And I would almost point you toward a different Cedric Price example, which is maybe Pottery's Think Belt, which is a series of kind of unused or abandoned infrastructural elements that are more of a network of elements that can be, in that case, it was for a school and for a training facility, but something that could be a little bit more piecemeal, a little bit more episodic, a little bit more emergent. And I agree with the time-based comment about how the growth of this new form of institutional identity could make itself manifest over, you know, months, years, and decades. And I think that would look differently than the kind of large building that you have.
I may jump in here. And Thea, would you mind going back a few slides when you have the fragments of your physical model and the drawing on the right? And while you do that, Samuel, actually has a problem with his microphone, so he's asking me to make a comment that I believe follows up on Frank's comment. This is Samuel's comment. The project seems to take the typology of a museum and use it as a political act in order for people to have an existence in the city as a city-town community, or other typologies considered as the vessel to gain back a voice, and what were some of the factors that led to settling on selecting the museum typology?
Yeah. I think that's fantastic. You did an incredible job.
Yes, I think slide 67 goes a bit towards explaining actually the bottom-up approach. Can you, maybe slide 67? Because if I remember correctly, this was more how you conceived of the aggregation over time. It was very much this bottom-up approach that you and Monica conceived of.
Yeah, because when conceiving this project, we had came up with like these different components that come together, I guess, like over time, which like results in this mega structure. But regarding other insect types of typologies that we considered, we did consider like a community center and community centers and I can't recall other ones that we've considered, but the reason that we were thinking of a museum is because since it is an institution where is displays like culture and other aspects of like the history of a society. We wanted to transform it so that we're able to use it so that it's not only these cultural aspects that were practiced years ago and have stopped and you just admire them. We wanted to have these, use a museum to actually continue practicing these, because especially in the history of the Philippines, since they have been colonized by Spain and Japan and the US, it was hard for Philippines to actually have its own Filipino identity. So we want to revive these traditional cultural practices to install, to use architecture in order to emphasize the social identity of the Philippines, to try to give them their identity back and
that's still my the construction crew is gone, so I can turn my mic back on. I think it's a wonderful project, and one of the things that I really like about it is that from the very beginning you ask what a museum can be, and it doesn't need to be confined, and we've talked about that throughout this discussion. It doesn't need to be defined by what museums used to be, And there are examples like Shumi's Park in Paris about what a park can be and all the different events that can go on inside of it. And what I was kind of driving at is, like, I appreciate how you believe and assume that architecture can be a political act, and you chose some sort of means as in which to do that, and it happened to be a museum, a living museum, which I think is a very appropriate title, and it goes along with your work, and it is more of a kind of incubation of preservation and the future and the different things that it can be. And so I appreciate it how, you know, you question about the past definitions of what a museum can be, along with it being a potential political act. And regardless of whether or not it's scalable or too big a size or not, or whether something's emergent or not, that was one of the kind of shortcomings of the situationalists, where they wanted to not it be defined, but then we find when you don't define something, you have to kind of be okay with what it can become. And you might not let it like what it becomes. So it's always this wanting to define something, but wanting to be open enough that it can become its own thing. And so I think it's a, you know, wonderful little exploration and kind of a museum as a city, big enough to be a city, and the kind of blurring between the challenges of a program and a building.
I have perhaps a silly question, but I'm looking at the model and this formal architecture, you know, the cutout in the planes, you know, those cutouts, which are fascinating to me. And how did you get to that? How did you get to those type of cutouts that are kind of pictorial? What in the exploration led you to make cutouts in the surface, like of the floor plane like that? Can you tell me? You know what I'm talking about?
Yes. So when we were originally, when we made the collage of mechanical systems, when we had, like, we took the different strips of the mechanical systems, and then we're making cutouts out of them based off of, maybe like the cutouts could either be like in plan, they can be places, they can become actual spaces. And then in the roof, they can become openings to let in light.
Okay. Thanks. Interesting way of one way of generating interesting. Thank you. I got it.
Monica, and Anthea, I just sent you an essay on Sri Lanka, and it's a very interesting essay that talks about national identity and sites of both memorials and museums. And I would just say that in the project, the museum is actually a very contested site, and there are really amazing examples around the world about that contestation. And I would look at a site like South Africa, right, where national identity is in flux. And I think that's part of what you want to get at. And I do think there's some amazing examples out there that will help you pinpoint a maybe a less generic understanding of the museum, you know, as a space of exhibition, and understand some of the, I would say, ideological work that museums did in their 19th century invention. Because I think that's important to sort of recognize. And I think back to the Columbia Exposition in 1893 that Daniel Burnham was very key in organizing. And it was an urban plan. I mean, and he adapted that sensibility through the City Beautiful movement and his design for Manila. But in that site, there was an exhibition of Philippines there. And part of the work that exhibition did was to primitivize, to define something called Filipino, and to also primitivize them as backwards so that Americans, you know, and the West could see themselves as modern. And so these spaces, like museums, are also things where civilization and culture, you know, did a certain kind of work. That has been under assault from day one by many different groups and many different people. And I think there's some really great examples out there that could help you maybe understand a little bit more about where your work fits in, because I feel that you're intuitively doing that work, you know, with the kinds of programming that you're thinking in the spaces that you've developed. But I also think, you know, you should start to find also precedents for that to ground it a bit more.
Thank you. Thank you everyone for your comments. Thank you, Monica and Anthea, for your presentation. Now, I suppose we'll have to move on to the next group, please. Thank you again, everyone, for your insightful comments, and we hope to see you in person very soon.
Abby, I'm going to be sharing my screen. Can everyone see that?
Yes.
Okay, so thank you to all the critics here today and engaging with this alternative architecture review. Thank you, Abby, for hosting. So we're looking forward to discussing You Will Never Understand with you all today. And we encourage everyone to visit Joshua Cooper's, just see his project webpage, which allows you to begin to deep dive into his project, film, and see critic conversations that are happening at the bottom of his page. So hopefully you guys all received that link. And if there's any comments that were not mentioned, we encourage you guys to put them here at the comments section to be memorialized with the project themselves. So the degree project theme, which is architecture and magic, is guided by Professor Adam Elstein, Jeffrey Hogreff, and I, if you guys could just say hello for a second.
Hello, everyone.
Adam. Hi, everybody.
Hi, Jeffrey.
Cool. So we're interested in the intersection of architecture, magic, and estrangement, which includes architecture's relationship with the uncanny, the strange, the weird, the alien, towards attraction and cognition. So we're seeing magic as both illusion, a set of effects towards the affect of delight and attraction, but also its ability to engage, interface to the exotic, alien, and the other, creating psychological affects. So Professor Adam Elstein and I have opened this theme to a set of sub-themes that each project in our studio builds upon. So we look at architecture and illusion, and architecture's long history in this, which is the ability to use theatrical illusions to hack spatial perceptions. And I enjoyed the first project that we saw today for that. Also, magic as deception, so creation of a set of effects using sleight of hand and large-scale deceptive assemblies. And we also view science as real magic. We looked at large-scale performances that were used to demonstrate towards effectual ends. It moves by itself. And lastly, estrangement and the alien, architecture's ability to create interface, the uncanny, the strange, the alien, picking up on our current discussions on architecture's relationship with the strange object and the non-human. We looked at the alien spectacle, in relationship to science fiction. And we looked at it towards the aesthetics of the spectacle and the encounters with otherness. Whoops, sorry, it's advancing by itself. And the benevolent other. Looking at, did I miss this slide? We looked at ectoplasm, the alien. Ectoplasm is a term used in spiritualism to describe a substance of spiritual energy. Exteriorized by physical mediums, a supernatural viscous substance as supposed to exude from the body of a medium during a spiritualistic trance and form the materials for the manifestation of spirits. And then here, the movie Still Image from the Arrivals, which is an alternative method of communication with heptapods, the benevolent alien that positions their ship across the globe, and it needs to be established, a language needs to be established in order to understand who they are and why they're here. So we asked as a class how architecture can act as interface, how could architecture form a way of communication with the perceived other. We are all also interested in the aesthetics of the alien, aesthetics not as what something looks like, but as an example of concept formation via sensation. So how stimulus becomes cognition. So Joshua Cooper's You Will Never Understand uses estrangement towards cognition. He started his research as a critique of modernism and evaluated who was excluded within its white walls, bringing forward the other in the form of the non-human to become the dominant species. So the aesthetics within the images that he's producing makes wakens the viewer and offers a deeper critique of our built world and who architecture is for. So I think it's a really profound project and super excited to present it here today. So from here, Josh offers a critique of through African-American experience within the built environment, focusing on Detroit as a place he knows well and the architectural response to this condition. So this project, I think, is important. He used the medium of film and architecture through the form of a mixtape to present a withdrawn experience and what can be described as most affective film that we've ever seen on Architecture Review. So with that, I introduce Josh, and You Will Never Understand.
Hi. Thank you, Michelle, for the introduction. So first, I'm going to start with, by the way, my name is Joshua Cooper, and my project is called You Will Never Understand. First, I want to start with the film, and then we'll go to part two.
And searched by the cops. Imagine having drugs planted in your car. Imagine a store owner following you. Imagine going to the wrong neighborhood. Imagine getting gunned down by police. Imagine being vilified. Imagine being tolerated but not accepted. Imagine a space protected by the
imagine
enemy.
A ghetto bird hovering over
imagine
you.
Imagine the cops riding up.
Imagine being falsely accused.
Imagine what it's like to be black in America.
Wait.
Had to face was both the removal of the white box that modernism loves so dearly, while also removing the ideology of slavery in our daily lives, whether it be a slave to the state, a slave to modernism, or a slave to capitalism. We all know the concept of slavery and have an idea about the hierarchy and the effects that it has on blacks, including me to this day. In the modern world, America is using an old concept but creates a new package for the same ideology that has held us back for centuries. For example, mass incarceration of Black Americans. Did you know during the crack epidemic, the minimum sentence for possession was 10 years, and you know what area they heavily policed? What about the fact that if you are placed in a privately owned prison, you are essentially a slave to the state? Did you know that the imprisonment rate of Black males for drug charges are 6 times more than their white counterparts, even though the possession of drugs between each groups are the same? Must be a coincidence. Another example would be the factory worker in the same existing building that the alien and the alienated are taking over, who worked all day in a big box just to come home in a smaller box, all for the machine called capitalism. The list goes on. Another challenge was this idea of control. The Red Ant not only works with its own generational memory of creating canals, but it also works on its true desires. If you look at the Conjuring map, the areas that are blinking are the placement of the sugar water. Because the ants desire food, it will flock to any of the areas that are blinking to fulfill this need. You know what's crazy? Is that you can't take the Conjuring map at face value. During one of my pinups, I was explaining this idea of conjuring and how the ants flock to these desirable areas, and only one crit got the hidden layer of the conjuring map. Shout out to Scott Ruff if you're watching. Dope guy. The hidden layer of the conjuring map is the ideology of the desires of the African Americans as well. If you take those same conjuring areas and add some historical backgrounds of African Americans, you will see that the ants and us are one and the same. While some desire money, sex, cars, etc., most Blacks desire the piece of the pie, the American dream. Going back to the end of slavery, Blacks began moving to the North for freedom and a new beginning at life. However, this came with stipulations. Detroit in specific redlined the city and gave particular areas to Black Americans migrating. What Blacks thought was a beginning of a new life was actually a way to control the masses. They would use these desires to lure them in a trap. What I learned from this study is that if you can control one's desires, you can control them. You notice how in New York, NYPD mostly patrols the public housing areas. Literally as we speak, 3 police cars just passed my block on the east side of Detroit, a predominantly Black neighborhood. It's because these areas were the original conjuring spots for African Americans. There are more similarities between the Red Ant and African Americans than just controlling the desires. For one, there's a hierarchy of respect between the queen and the worker ant, like my mother or grandmother and I. There's also the similarity of congregating underground. For example, red ants store their food and their dead underground and in the same exact places, while Blacks plan majority of their movements underground, quote unquote, or in concealment. For example, the Underground Railroad, Black Panthers movement, Civil Rights movement, and BLM. Another similarity is how the oppressor views Blacks and the red ant. Insects are seen as monsters, while Black men in particular are vilified in America. It's pretty crazy to see how the oppressor responds to the quote-unquote monsters in these worlds. For example, when the ant is minding its business in the oppressor's kitchen, they kill it. And when they see African Americans minding their business, they... Anyway, back to the program.
Baby, you understand me now. If sometimes you see that I'm mad, don't you know no one alive can always be an angel? When everything goes wrong, you see some bad. Understood.
so hard, so please don't let me be misunderstood.
There's everyone. Okay. So now I'm going to part two. So modern architecture prospered on the idea of innovation, minimalism, functionalism, while rejecting the alien. These spaces were created by white men, producing a barrier between the privileged and the oppressed, while removing the entities that were once considered unclean and uncanny, all in the interest of aesthetics. If architecture is to address the wants, needs, and desires of the alien and the alienated that were once whitewashed in modern spaces, it must reintroduce the alien to create ecological systems and rebuild from the carcass of modernism so as to confront oppression and architectural systems. The Packer plant sits in the heart of Detroit's east side between a major freeway and intersection. The plant thrived during the automotive boom. However, the automotive company went out of business in the early 50s. Since the 60s, the infrastructure that housed the automakers have been left abandoned with no plans of demolition or rehabilitation. The alien began invading both at the larger scale of the factories and at the individual scale of the house, due to the desertion of the automotive industry and workers that survived from them. The building that was once a statue of modernism, industrialism, and capitalism and discrimination is now overtaken by the same entities that it's trying to displace. The Packer plant and the community that resides around it is the effect of a dying economy and racial tension that ripple throughout the city. To incorporate the alien on the site, one must control their desires. Conjuring is the idea of the alienated calling upon the alien to appear. The alienated does this by creating attraction spots around the site and building in order for the alien to expose itself from the underground. In the smaller physical test, the ritual of conjuring started with attracting the ant with sugar water to result in canals being built in the sand. This ideology of conjuring is derived from ectoplasm photography that depicts an exorcism or evil spirit that is extracted from the body, and also Veve symbols, which represents the astral forces descending to earth during African voodoo ceremonies. Just like ectoplasm and Veve, the alien is being extracted and exposed from the cracks of the Packer building. In this world we live in, we can only trust our instincts, our hearts, and our queen. When we were born, no one told us how hard life would actually be for us. The generation before paved the way and broke barriers for us to have a more comfortable experience. However, the world feels like it hasn't pushed forward, and we're stuck under constant scorn and surveillance. They watch us 24/7, like a guard watching an inmate. We're institutionalized to think this is normal, to live in fear, go where we're told, and understand why they do it. We try to build our own spaces of concealment, but they still find a way to gentrify and appropriate the only areas we have. We slave to get a seat at the table, taking the bare minimum to create, while also forming a culture where we can thrive, but it seems that it all goes to waste due to the oppressor. The oppressor then steals and capitalizes on the success of the space. The horrifying part of the situation is that we work like machines in order to provide for the family, but society turns the other way. They don't see us picking the dead homies up from the ground, the tears in our queen's eyes when we get added to the pile, or the constant ridicule from the oppressor. So when the time comes when we are exposed and create our own seat, or create our own table and our own skins with crowns on our heads, Don't try to understand us, because you will never understand the struggle. You would never understand the struggle because you would never understand how we got to this point of excellence. Thank you.
Wow, I'll start. This is just a truly extraordinary project. It's stunning. It's everything about it for me is beautiful, except for the condition from which it starts. And so I was rapt from the beginning. Obviously, we got to see these ahead of time, and truly, truly taken by every aspect of it. And I guess I just had a couple of questions for you. Stemming, I guess, from the emotion and where it comes from. It seems to me so formulated. And I'm just curious, A, if this is, obviously this is something that you live with, a story that you live with, but in terms of a project, if it's a project that you've been thinking about even prior to this, because just the way you pulled everything together to me is extraordinary. And then the second is just from your viewpoint. To me, you've made something so beautiful. And at the end of this, do you see what you've done as something, I can't say it any other way, beautiful? In other words, have you made the Packard plant something of beauty and experience, or is it still something else? But again, thank you. Just an extraordinary project.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments. So I've been wanting to do a project like this for 3 years now. Ever since I had an amazing professor who is, I don't know if he's in the call right now. Yeah, he is, Scott Ruff. And just all of the issues, like African-American experience that I've had and what you see on the news and what you see on social media, like it's just really, it really saddened me. And I wanted to create something where it could be a safe haven for people who look just like me. I mean, I'm a kid with braids in my hair, like, come on. So I really wanted to create something meaningful, powerful, but also allow for people who look just like me to have a space for comfort. And as for your second question, it's more of creating, like, based off of an aesthetic, for me, it's beautiful, but it was more about giving people a platform than the aesthetics for me. I really wanted to create something where people who look just like me have a space, because all of the spaces that we used to have in Detroit are gentrified now or they're completely abandoned. So I wanted to, you know, take this opportunity to create something special.
Very special. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Joshua, it's Mabel Wilson. That was a phenomenal meditation on the condition of Black life.
Thank you.
Both in New York and in America, and I would just say globally. I was curious, have you watched Arthur Jaffa's Love is the Message, The Message is Death?
No, I have not.
Oh, you haven't?
No, I haven't.
Oh, wow. Okay. You absolutely have to see that work, because what you produced is very much, it's very much reflective of the way in which AJ works. He was actually trained as an architect initially. No, he always wanted to be an architect. He never was. He's a cinematographer. He did the cinematography for Daughters of the Dust. He worked with Stanley Kubrick, I think, on Eyes Wide Shut. He's an amazing artist, and he just won the Golden Lion last year at the Venice Biennale. But anyway, my point in bringing that up is that AJ uses aliens in that work, and his argument are twofold. One, he says that Blackness is you know, blackness produces the condition for black people to operate as aliens in society. So exactly right. The thematic of the studio. But he also uses sound. He says the space of black culture is actually sonic. It's the rhythm. And he uses a Kanye, piece to basically animate all of these found clips. And people cry when they see it. It's profoundly moving. And so your work actually reminds me a lot of AJ's project in that regard. And I think in that way, it's completely spot on about how the condition of blackness gets produced and that we live that. And I say blackness more broadly, because I think brown people live that condition of blackness, poor people live that condition of blackness, particularly under racial capitalism. And this world is built. There is an architecture that builds those inequalities as we're experiencing now in the city. Right. And I think you really touch upon that. And so I would just say that I think you're starting to kind of maybe find those spaces in which you could start to understand how to spatialize, build black spaces. And I feel like maybe the Ant's the right one, how they might recolonize a site like the Packer Plant, which is, Matt, talk about massive structural megastructure. I noticed the bridge finally fell down on the plant.
Right.
I mean, I think that there is a way in which the sonic could be key and might sort of change how that space is occupied, and already has, because that was always a site also of underground parties and things like that. The other thing I will point you to, and I'll upload the reading to the chat, is a piece by a philosopher named Sylvia Winter, who said that under slavery, the plantation produced, and the plantation is basically the, she argues the plantation is the factory that makes industrial capitalism possible. And even right. Marx even acknowledges that. But she said in the plantation was also a space called the plot. The plot was precisely where Africans turned into Negroes, turned into blacks, turned into slaves, were able to sustain themselves, grow their own food, and congregate, which is where musical practices, things like voodoo, candomblé, all of the kinds of religions, but also sites of revolt. Plots were plotted in the plot. And she calls it the site of the underlife. And I feel like what you're describing in your work is precisely that site of the underlife that has existed constantly. And oftentimes it's musical space, it's the ghetto, it's the favela. So she describes it in all of these terms historically to today. But she says it's also a cultural space. And one of the things is it's about dance, it's about sound, and a number of things, which in and of themselves can be co-opted into capitalism, she warns.
Right.
Yeah. So I think that there is much more to be made in how you're thinking and building those spaces, I think, in the Packer Plant around sound, dance, color, light, and even materiality.
I'm actually just gonna type my three suggestions to you, and so everybody else can talk. It was amazing. I have three books that I think that you might be interested in, and like human psychology. I've read them. They've been like very influential in my thinking. And so I'm just gonna type them in the thing and you can look at them. Maybe it's of interest, and I'll just let other people kind of chime in.
Okay, thank you.
Josh, thank you for the shout out.
no problem.
I am humbled beyond can be mentioned here in many ways. And very impressive work. And I did end up writing something on your blog, as always, like architect at the last minute. But some of those things that I wrote within your blog, I'll mention here. And one of them is this idea that, one, you're taking on a lot of ground. You know, you're skipping across the ocean from racial injustice, social injustice, not just racial, social injustice. And to ants, and then, you know, and how those ants are motivated by sugar, and then an AI parametric kind of modeling of the movements of ants. And so, I mean, that's a lot of leaps and bounds in an extremely short period of time in your process, let alone for introducing that to us. But then there's also this, fact that what you're actually doing is also part of the age that we're in, right? This is, in many ways, if I look at it as an Afrofuturist type of project, one that does leap into, you know, this kind of sci-fi approach to trying to move beyond the kind of depression that comes from living within those conditions that you so eloquently kind of explain and show to us. And how is it that you can move beyond that condition to now speculate about a possible future? Now, that future might seem a little dystopian and or I'm gonna say alien. I'm not gonna say the future that you're projecting is an alien one, because I don't think that you're necessarily projecting a future. I think your project here really questions what is architecture, and how is it that we really start to discuss the definition of space and then where is this safe space? You know, you have just created, it's interesting that you called it the hallway here, or it is called, sometimes called the hallway, but we have created and you've developed a kind of virtual space here and where you are open and free to talk about and to have a discussion about your fears, your pains, and aspirations, all in, you know, a safe space, so to speak. And so you have created that through your project and not necessarily through the artifact and the object of the intervention that you made inside the Packard plan. And so, you know, like I said, that's one of the things that really resonates with me, that it's something that we need to really question, you know, what is the definition of space? So, and I enjoy that, that you have projected us into that area. There is that other aspect of it that leaves us, so if you've conjured this space for us here, you leave us haunted with wanting more. And so I'm just sitting here, even at this moment, like saying, okay, so what does this form mean that, you know, is kind of derived from a study of ants and their movements and how they make form in space, which, you know, we can talk about how what that relationship is, but what are its implications in our reality, right? And that's what we're left wanting. And I would say, under the guise of this studio, haunted in that sense. And so I can be okay there because we are operating in this world of magic at some level. But then there's this other part of me that's very physical, very, you know, concrete, that's just saying, and an architecture professor, studio professor, that's saying, you know, so where is do you take that next leap? And say, can we make the ectoplasmic physical? Can we touch and walk in that world that you have conjured, you know? So that's some of the thoughts that I'm left with. So not much a question or for a response, but
I would add to Scott's point, can we build outside of architecture? And what would that mean? What would that look like outside the white box?
Thank you for making that a question.
I'm hesitant to speak because, I I take what you say, and I know that in my own position I cannot understand. But because we're all here discussing the work, and I for one am really moved by it, and I think maybe I would go, maybe I'll talk from a slightly different perspective, which would be like building on what was just said on what would be the next step. And if you were to apply your approach, or let's say expand your approach, I think one thing that I would consider doing is looking at other sites in Detroit. Because I think you made a very compelling case about the Packer plant, but I think that so much of the inequity that's in the city of Detroit is really built into property, real property. Mm-hmm. And so, I'm not going to be talking so much about the Sonic side of the project, but about like really taking it seriously as a proposal about building power and building separate power. I think that I would look to some of these other places in the city where you actually, where it might be easier or it might be less isolated or maybe impactful in different ways where you could test out your design thinking. So like right now I'm working on a project in Detroit where we're looking at all the vacant city-owned schools. And I think about like the vacant school and the school system in Detroit and how that plays into all of the inequity and the sort of the condition of the alien in the history of the city. And I think that could be an interesting site. Or if we look at, say, some of even just the residential property, the individual home. And so I just think that if you were to take the project to the next step, if there's a next step, and I'm not the one to say if there's a next step or what that next step should be. But I do think that really, like, it would be very hard. Like, you could, these factories, these abandoned factories, are kind of really, really massive, and they are alienated. They're very separate, but they're also very hard to acquire. And I just think that it might be interesting to look at other forms of property that could actually be, that might show different models of acquisition in which to build the project. And so I think it's kind of a blurry and maybe not totally clear set of comments, but I also don't want, I'm just kind of musing here in the wash of after watching your presentation. And I do think that I take it so seriously, and not just as an art project, but really as something that could be built. And if you were to do that, I would encourage you to not only apply the thinking to the monument of the factory, but to other sites in the city.
Yeah, and I agree. So there is a next step. There is a next step to the process. What I plan on doing for the remainder of my life is I really want to challenge this idea of the individual space, as like you said, more specifically the stoop. The stoop is really important in African-American culture, because that's where we congregate as, not as a community, but as individuals with immediate family. Especially here in Detroit. I mean, like going to my grandmother's house and sitting on the front porch, like that's really important. That's where we have all our like life's conversations. So I really want to challenge the idea of using this form to become a protector for those intimate spaces like the stoop.
Hmm.
So, well, I didn't want to interrupt you, Scott. Were you about to jump in? Okay. Okay, you're muted, but I'm reading your lips and I'm getting what you're saying, I think. Thank you. This is a classic Zoom interaction. Thank you, Joshua. Like others have already said, I think Georgine said it really well. I fall into that classic category of being modestly aware, but can't understand, as you say. I must say the pervasive ant metaphor really gave me pause and was really, and not because other aspects of your presentation weren't powerful, but it kind of, it hit me as a like, wait, did he just say ant? And I'm really excited to just learn, because I think it's, as other people have said, it's really a powerful way of linking the architecture and architecture's culpability, architecture's various kind of baggages and tropes with this social political by giving us this sort of natural in between. And so this is a project that's not about the natural, but relies on the natural as a rhetorical device and production device, and then is confident enough to say that nature is also present in the outcome. So I find that very powerful. I think there's I want to try to get a sense of your internal struggles about the level of resolution of the product and how visible it is. I'm struck by like the salient forms of ant life are not the ant hill, right? So right. How did you decide, and how did you struggle? What are your open-ended questions? Because you know you've tied things up really well, and you know I like that we can talk about this form, but your presentation and the form itself makes it clear that there's more to be seen here. You know, I'm also, if you could go back, I find it really powerful to look at these two images and to look at, you know, the difference between them and your confident movement between them. You know, I would say this is really clear as a kind of formal representation, an architecturally formal representation that is not meant to exist out in the, not in the open, but like exposed to the sky, existing on the ground rather than under the ground, right? So again, right. I'm having difficulty forming a question, but I am trying to pull something out of you that I might really learn from about your thoughtful decisions about scope, scale, process, metaphor. Can you take that and just riff off that and pretend it's a question?
Yeah, I can try, and if I'm totally missing the mark, like you can chime in. But so one of the biggest problems, the issues that I've had, let me start with the project started with working with a very, very small, like working at essentially ant scale. And my biggest issue was how can I make something bigger that is like way smaller than a human? So that's where, and I'm still having trouble like working with the different scales. But when I started using AI to help kind of help me with the form, that's when all of the questions came into play. The questions came into play about how big I can go, how small I can go, how many ants can fit into this one tube or this one canal, like all those types of questions. And then as for the metaphors, I honestly, I'm gonna be honest. When I first started this process last semester, I saw no direct correlation between the alien and the alienated. I saw them as two different things. It wasn't until I started working with the ants themselves. And, you know, I have like footage, and then, you know, they literally were on my desk every day, and literally seeing how they operated just clicked something in my head. And I was just like, oh, wow. Like, not only is the hierarchy the same as us, but also, you know, their view, like, to humans, you know, to mm-hmm. all humans, like, when you see an ant, like, you don't think anything of it. You kill it if it's in your kitchen. So I'm just, when I was like, okay, well, like, we see these creatures as like minuscule things, like, they don't mean anything to our lives, but actually they are very important and very necessary. So once I started studying the ants, that's when I was just like, okay, well, you know, now let me bring in Blacks and then my experiences, and I'm just like, okay, like, there's a lot of similarities. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that answers.
Yeah, that's super exciting. I mean, it's even further complicated by the idea that like an AI is kind of like an ant in the sense that intelligence is distributed by unintelligent parts, right? Like, almost always you zoom in any level of an AI and you conclude with certainty that there's no intelligence there, but you zoom out and it's undeniable that there are traits of intelligence. So that I, as you talk about this, I also, it's clear that there are places where the ant metaphor as a life break down, right? And so there's also clear spots where you, as this project proceeds, there's clearly a moment where, you know, you'll need to, and I think it, you already are drawing a clear distinction between what, like, when something artificial might step in and what you as an architect might do to make sure that that distributed intelligence is not confused for the life form that wants to be sort of exposed and respected, right? So there's like, I guess what I'm saying is there's a little bit of a double-edged sword, right? Like when, I find that really, I like that your metaphor explains so much and has been so useful for you, but then is also a really risky metaphor, right? Like it's allowed me to ask a political question under the kind of protection of the abstraction of the ant, right? So it's also, it's given like a lifeline to, and I have no intention of having an out and making any of this abstract, right? Like, your presentation was really good, but this is not anything, it can't be abstracted and shouldn't be abstracted. Not really a question, but one thing I would like to ask the future you, if I could put this in a time capsule, is in 1 or 5 years, how will you address the ant metaphor, right? Like, when did you leave it and how did you leave it? And when you left it, on what terms were you with it when you broke up with the ant? Abstractly.
5 years, where do I see? I still see, in 5 years, I'm gonna be honest, I still see myself working with ants, but I do see myself also working with other intelligence that mm-hmm. aren't non-human. Mm-hmm. So during this process, I also worked with a golden orb weaver, a mm-hmm. spider that was supposed to weave between this form, you know, mm-hmm. and create an enclosure, but it was a failed attempt. Mm-hmm. So I really, really want to go back, and I don't want to get rid of anything that I'm working on now. I would just honestly perfect it, but mm-hmm. also I really want to start working with other forms of tech or other forms of intelligence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm into that. So, Call me in 5 years, but call me also every step of the way in between, because this sounds super exciting.
Will do.
So I was just going to step in one more time, and actually I'm going to kind of continue on what I was doing before. I feel like I can't really benefit by commenting too much without this, like, maybe giving some things that you might find of interest to read or look at when you're developing all this stuff. You talk a lot about metaphors, maybe didn't talk a lot about metaphors, but that's a word that's been using. Work by Joseph Campbell. He's a very important writer, and definitely in the last 100 years, on the power of myth and metaphors, and why all cultures or a lot of cultures have them, and why they're important, and how we create comparisons so we understand ourselves or what's going on in the world. And also another book, and I'll write these down in the little chat thing. There's a couple of books by Joseph Campbell. He's one of his big ones is The Hero of a Thousand Faces. But he also has the book on Power of Myth and the Journey of the Hero, and which, oh my gosh, I'm a Star Wars fan. The director of Star Wars, I can't believe that I'm blinking right now in front of like everybody, but like Star Wars is built on a lot of his work. And also another book by Ernest Becker is called The Birth and Death of the Meeting. So anyway, it's a lot of my stuff is like more social psychology, but we know that all this inner stuff comes forth in our art and how we operate and live in the world. So.
Right.
Hi. Hello. I'd like to, so one of the things that was really intriguing about your movie and your explorations is your determination to still extract delight while being real, which to me is something that's so embedded in African American culture and which was manifested in so many of the songs. And so one of my questions is, did you show this to grandma, and did it bridge to her sense of delight?
I have family right now that's in Florida. I have a great grandmother. She is 99 years old. Her name is Grandma Alice. That's my heart, my soul. And she's also the inspiration for this project. This is also dedicated to her and my other great grandmother and my grandmother. I don't know if she's seen it. I know that I have great uncles and great aunties who are her kids. They've seen it, and they texted me yesterday because I showed them yesterday. And they were like, oh my God, like I have an uncle and they all lived in Detroit like during the riots, and I had an uncle and he was just in tears. And I just, even though like it's so hard to say that they find delight, I don't know. Like, I feel like they're happy at the fact that I'm using my voice, and this has nothing to do with me. This has nothing to do with me. They're happy that I'm using my voice, but they were more saddened at the fact that literally a lot of that stuff happened, you know, during the 1900s, 60s, 70s, 80s, you know, in their prime, and all of that is still happening now. I mean, mm-hmm. So. I don't know if that answers your question, but I know that they're proud of me because I made the film, and they're proud of me because, I don't know if that answers your question. I'm sorry.
Your film, your presentation, your thoughtfulness are really incredible. And it's a beautiful film, and it's really well thought through. And this notion of whatever the experiences we had for 50 years, there's this notion of of delight in our culture, you know, delight that we bring with our families and
despite all that.
And there's a hint of that in your film, which I think should be broadened, perhaps architecturally. You know, what's a delightful space that my grandmother and my brothers and sisters can come together and feel that feeling that we know we have, but it's hard to articulate, it's hard to put into words, but how you generate that space, that's probably your next step, that we could, a place that we find comforting, rewarding, and a place that we find peace.
Right.
If I do offer some level of a shameless plug that I'm about to put forward, so Jeffrey Holgrief and myself and also Ashley Simone, who's also here, we are coming out with a text, In Search of African American Space, and also Sarah Caples and Everardo Jefferson are in that text, in which we discuss or try to engage this notion of delight in spite of all of the negativity. So pessimism, the Afro-pessimism that, there is this, you must still find joy somewhere, but there's always this specter. Again, we come back to these magical terms of specter, ectoplasm, things of that nature. But these intangible things that lurk within each of these spaces, that it's not meant for anyone to move beyond, but you must at least put aside. And I think that your project operates within that. And as people have already just said here, that it begins to speak to bringing forward that type of emotion within space or within the discussion. And so it's an intellectual space that we're talking about right now. And, what does that mean and what does that manifest when it becomes physical? But does it have to is also a question. Does it have to become physical? You know, what are your thoughts on that? Does it have to become physical?
I feel like going into the project, I felt like there had to be physical. I mean, just off the strength of we don't really have, like, I can't name any space that I can go to right now in Detroit where I feel like, okay, this is my community, I'm comfortable. And because a lot of those areas are gentrified right now. Or they're starting to become gentrified. So when I was going into this project, I wanted it to be a safe haven, but I also wanted it to be like this physical thing in the ground that literally is a barrier between, you know, any outside oppressors for people to, you know, have like quote unquote this like therapeutic, you know, moment. So the beginning of this process, and I'm still to this, still now, I want it to be, it's a physical thing.
Well, you know, it's interesting because it also has a terrifying look to it, right?
The
what was made. And I wonder about that type of, what does that mean for you? That this kind of repulsive, the alien that's in inside your project. What do you mean with that? What do you mean to bring forward with that?
So the reason why it's really interesting because the whole conceptual thinking is that the alienated or black people living in Detroit would create these spaces. Right, so they already know that they already have an idea of what's going to happen and how it's going to look, right? But then the people who are not accustomed to it are going to, like, you know, they're not going to try to mess with it. So that was the whole idea, that it becomes like this protective barrier. It's just like, now I'm going to leave it at that. So
I want to leave it there. Okay. I think you know, I really enjoyed this conversation today with this expanded panel. And Josh, I just want to thank you for bringing us along this incredible journey. And I think we're all interested to remain in this conversation with you. And over the next 5 years, I echo Carl in that. And it's been an absolute pleasure to work with you and since first year. So I want to just say how meaningful this is to be here with you today. So thank you so much. And thank you for this entire panel.
Yeah, and thank you, panel. And I just want to thank you for all the comments. And thank you, Michelle and Adam and Jeffrey. You guys are amazing.
Are you in New York right now?
No, I'm in Detroit right now.
You are in Detroit.
15 okay, minutes away from my site.
have you ever ridden Amtrak from New York to Washington, D.C.? And the reason why I'm asking is because the project I'm working on is in D.C. And I've had to go down numerous times over the course of the last couple of years, and I'm still going down. And I was never imagining the impact of just sitting and riding on the train and watching an American landscape go by. And as you go through all these different sections of the city, from places that are seeing hard times to places that are the white picket fences. And so I was just curious if you've ever had the opportunity to do that or not.
No, I have not. I haven't taken the Amtrak like ever.
So. Well, maybe this, I don't know if I can get in trouble for doing this, but when you come back, I have so many Amtrak points. I think you're an amazing filmmaker, or you seem like you like have a thing with film as well. Please, I have many Amtrak points, and I think you would be like blown away by one train ride and what you would see.
All right, I want to end it there, and please, okay, for everyone, go back and leave comments. Mabel, great to see you here too. Leave comments on Josh's blog post. It will stay live forever. Until the internet gets shut down. So thank you so much.
Bye, everybody.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.